Ms. Mohamed has been working on behalf of refugees for the past 8 years. Her most recent work was with the Arizona Refugee Resettlement Program, which is where I first met her a few years ago, where she administered several grants and programs. She's always been a strong advocate for refugees' access to early childhood education and care, and has worked with Arizona Head Start programs to facilitate a centralized enrollment process for refugee families. Her work with Head Start and refugee families has been used as an example of promising practice. She's currently the owner and chief executive officer of a child welfare agency that serves children in the state's custody. She advocates for children and families that are in the state's child welfare system. She also holds a dual degree, master's degrees in public administration and international relations from Syracuse University and the Maxwell School of Citizenship and Public Affairs. So welcome and thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you guys. Thank you all. Thank you very much. I think there's no need for me to stand over there because it's a small, you know, it's a small group and we can be very intimate. If I don't say anything in the presentation that you hope to hear, I am very happy to you know, answer any questions that you have. So hopefully we can, you know, we can talk more intimately. You can ask me questions that you really want to know about refugee resettlement in general and mostly about the Somali experiences. So Somalia is a country that is located in the Horn of Africa in East. So if you're familiar with the map of Africa, Somalia is where the, you know, that little thing, you know, looks like a horn. And when in international development you refer to the Horn of Africa, it's mostly, you know, referencing Somalia, a little bit of Djibouti as well. So, you know, there's been a lot of problems going on in Somalia for the past, you know, more than two decades, you know, for as long as, you know, I've known. A lot of people ask me, where are you from? I'm from Kenya, but I'm ethnically Somali. I'm from an area of Kenya that is technically, you know, part of, you know, historically was part of Somalia, but is now part of Kenya because of, you know, the demarcation of Africa and, you know, a lot of political issues that went on, you know, during colonial times. So I relate very much to the Somali people from Somalia because the Somalis, unlike, you know, different other groups, you know, the Somalis from Kenya, Somalis from Djibouti, Somalis from Somalia are one Somali because we come from a homogeneous culture where we speak one language. We have the same religion. 99% Somalis are Muslims, they're Sunnis. We speak one, you know, language with a few dialects, but for the most part, every Somali understands a Somali. A Somali Bantu understands a Somali. There's Maymay, that is, you know, a dialect that's different from mainstream Somali language. But for the most part, everything is the same, but we cannot get along, you know. And that's because of, you know, clan politics. You know, there's supremacy that one clan feels for the other, and the issue has been for so long, who's going to rule and who's not going to rule. And this clan is not going to rule me, this clan is not going to lead. And so there's been a lot of, you know, issues, you know, politically in that part of the continent. So Somalis have been living in refugee camps. They started fleeing in 1991. My sister, who was born then, is now, you know, she has graduate degrees and she has children. She's, you know, she's an old person. She's 27 years old. So what I'm trying to say is the war has been going on for a very long time, and therefore people have been moving from that country in masses to the neighboring countries. They've been seeking asylum in Kenya mostly. In 1991, I remember for a whole year, my family, the kids, you know, in my family didn't sleep on a bed because we had a lot of relatives that came, and so we had to host them, welcome them, and help them out. A lot of the Somalis didn't have that opportunity to live, you know, in a home or, you know, to be welcomed by a relative. Most of them ended up in Dadaab. Dadaab refugee camp is one of the largest refugee camps, I want to say, in the world, or maybe the largest refugee camp in the world. And it was initially, you know, developed to host 90,000 people. Today it has, you know, close to 400,000 people. I've had the opportunity to visit the camp, and you know, the situation there is bad. It's not good. It's harsh. You know, there's a lot of people that have languished in those camps for, you know, years and years, and kids losing hopes and, you know, mothers, you know, having children, seven children at the refugee camp. You know, some kids don't know anywhere but the refugee camp. And so in resettlement, you know, the UNHCR, you know, usually has three solutions, durable solutions, they call them. One is to integrate in the country for first asylum. In this case, for Somalis, it's mostly Kenya. When we talk about Somalis, we're talking about them coming to Kenya. There's very few Somalis that went to Ethiopia and few Somalis that went to Djibouti. So integration in the country of asylum usually is very, very difficult because oftentimes they're going to countries that are also having their own sets of economic challenges. Kenya, for example, in as much as they're willing to extend and help, there's just so much that they can do. So integration is usually out of the, you know, picture. And the second option is repatriation. Repatriation doesn't happen often because, you know, for such countries like Somalia, the war has been ongoing. It's hostile to go back to Somalia. And the third option is resettlement. 1% of, you know, the world's refugee population gets that opportunity, and very few Somalis get. It does look like it's a lot of Somalis coming here to the US, to Arizona specifically, but that's a drop in the bucket, you know, when you look at the larger scale of the things that are going on at the camp. So refugees come to Arizona, you know, through a process. You know, the process is very long. It's extensive background checks, extensive medical checks. They're thoroughly vetted to come here, and they're prioritized for, you know, the needs. A lot of the times, the cases that are prioritized are cases that, you know, have high needs, such as, you know, a single mother that has eight children, maybe three of the children are disabled, or two of the children are sick, or she has, you know, major thing going on with her, terminal illness or something, you know, so she's prioritized on. Other people that are prioritized on, you know, youth that are unaccompanied. So the people that are coming here, people that really do need, you know, that help, do need that opportunity to start life again, and to thrive. When they come to Arizona, they're received by the resettlement agencies that sponsor them. The resettlement agencies have a contract through the Department of State because the Department of State does the initial transitional assistance, in addition to the overseas, you know, process. So the transitional assistance is help with housing, help with initial case management. So that would include, you know, enrolling the kids in schools. It would include, you know, following up on, you know, things that were identified during, you know, the overseas processes. If there's any medical, you know, issues that were identified, it is the resettlement agency's, Department of State's role to, you know, do the initial health assessment. And then after that, the state refugee program takes over the longer term, you know, services. So the short-term assistance is very, very short in duration. It's very limited. It's very limited, especially for a mother that has, you know, zero employability skills, that has a lot of children, that has a lot of barriers, you know, around her getting a job. So help with housing for 3 months, yes, is good, but it's not enough for specific cases, you know. For the cases that are coming as, you know, single, you know, free cases, they call them, there's hope that, you know, they can, you know, even so, if they're coming from a pre-literate culture, you know, like the Somalis who are coming from pre-literate backgrounds, you're talking about somebody who's not, you know, used to holding a pen, who's not exposed to Western culture, everything is new to them. So having them find a job in 3 months is just, you know, it's beyond, you know, expectation. You know, you can't expect somebody who's never, ever been outside the camp, or who's just always had to live with trauma, you know, who doesn't have any skills to start walking in 3 months. So the assistance is very limited, and once families find out housing especially is coming to an end, that's when everything, you know, starts, you know, surfacing. mental health issues become, you know, come up, then mental health issues trickle down to the kids. The kids struggle at school. Kids go to school very sad because, you know, they've always known mom to be struggling. They've always known to not be happy at the camp. And then, you know, they're very excited to come to America. And America is a nightmare again. You know, mom is very stressed. I'm very stressed because I can't speak. I'm different from everybody in my school. And so challenges start, you know, kicking in for the families. And this is when you see, this is when I, you know, with my experience, this is when I've seen issues, you know, surfacing. Sometimes, you know, the educators or, you know, people in the school districts, you know, pick up on things, you know, with those kids that might be misinterpreted as, you know, children neglected or children, you know, not happy or children just going through things that are not, you know, understood. So I would say that, you know, cultural competency would help, you know, with staff that are working at the schools if they are aware of the challenges that these kids are coming with. You know, the backgrounds that they're coming from, things that would, if they're aware, if they're educated about things that would help, if they can be connected to services, you know, in the schools, that would be, you know, of so much help. And if, you know, moms can be helped with mental health issues, because mental health is a taboo in the Somali culture, nobody talks about it, nobody addresses it, nobody believes in it. We believe that, you know, everything can be cured, you know, with, you know, spirituality and, you know, being good to God and, you know, doing your prayers. So if there can be awareness, if, you know, families can be made aware of mental health services that are, you know, available to them, and if there can be cultural breakers, you know, people who can, you know, be connecting those families to the services, who look like them, who speak their language, who understand them, who know that this is a sensitive topic, this is a topic that you cannot talk about in public, that you cannot share with anybody, I think that would be a great help. Ways that, you know, academia or the school can help is, I would think, you know, encouraging or, you know, trying to attract the youth in the refugee communities. The Somalis have a lot of potential. Naturally, you know, my experience has been that they really want to learn, you know, and the parents really prioritize an education, because the way they look at it is, I didn't have an opportunity. My dad didn't take, especially the women, my dad didn't take me to school. I want my daughters to go to school. So, you know, trying to, you know, break into the communities, you know, and especially the youth, and trying to mentor them, you know, showing them what a university looks like, giving them scholarships. I know it's easy to say, but, you know, if we can do little things that can, you know, attract, you know, those kids to come to ASU, to study, we need a lot of social workers that are representing the community, because you want to hear from your own, you know, especially if you're coming from an environment where you are afraid of, you know, everybody else, you're afraid of the government, you're afraid of, you know, the administration, anything that looks like authority to you, you're afraid of them because you've lived a life whereby those are the people that, you know, threatened you, those are the people that, you know, made your life miserable. So you want to hear from people that are like you, somebody who they can identify with, people who came with, you know, their similar circumstances, you know, it would be easy for them to listen, you know. I would come across, you know, a family that has gotten into the child welfare system, and there's a lot of, you know, misinterpretation on what has happened with the family, how the kids were taken away. And the minute they see me, the minute they know that I'm speaking their language, the minute they know that, you know, I know what's going on, I know their practices, they open up, they tell you the real stories. And so you can help, you know, the system. I'm talking about, you know, us trying to educate the young in the community to be able to help them with services that they need. They'll open up, they'll talk about what they need, versus, you know, somebody who's not, you know, familiar to them, somebody who doesn't look like them talking to them and explaining to them. I would like to see you know, the school districts, like I said, the schools have school psychologists that are culturally competent that can pick on things that, you know, can pick on things that the families have gone through and are going through, and not going to brand the children as, you know, defiant, as, you know, it takes somebody to really, you know, understand what is going on in a young, you know, young child's mind, a child who just doesn't know what to do because he wants to help the mom, because we come from a place whereby it is your responsibility to help your mom, it's your responsibility to help your dad. You're 13 years old, 14 years old, if you're in Africa, if you're in Somalia, you would be taking care of the home, you would be doing everything. You want to do those things, but you also want to go to school. You want to help your mom, but you can't help pay for her rent because, you know, the levels are such that you can go to work, you can do certain things at a certain time. So a lot of the kids do things that, you know, take them to the wrong place. So if the school psychologist can be educated, they can be trained. If the teachers can get some orientation on who the Somalis are, where they're coming from, how they're different from the other refugee groups, how they've lived. They're probably one of the groups that have lived the longest in refugee camps. You know, I think that would help. Overall, I would say that Somalis do want to walk, contrary to what many folks, you know, see or think. The reason why a lot of Somalis are not, you know, getting, you know, gainful employment easily is because of, you know, the barrier with the language. They're coming from a culture that doesn't write. A culture where, you know, people just talk, an oratory culture. So, and I myself, when I worked in refugee resettlement, kept thinking, it should be easy to get a job as a dishwasher because I didn't do employment. I did case management. I did, you know, mostly policy work. And I always thought there has to be a way that these people can go to work. But it came, I faced a reality when I had, you know, a young refugee girl placed in one of my group homes. She was moving on to independent living. She was 17, so she's turning 18. We're trying to help her get those, you know, skills to be able to live independently. And part of it was to, you know, she's getting a stipend to pay, you know, her rent, but it's not enough because she has to have, you know, money to, you know, to pay for everything else, you know, the bills. 750 is what she was getting. That's not going to be enough to pay for an apartment and other expenses. We tried to take her to McDonald's, to Burger King, to everywhere, you know, get a dishwashing job, you know, whatever, cleaning the dishes. And they want, nobody would take her. The minute she applies, she gets calls. But the minute they start, you know, hearing her, or they start asking her the questions, because she's not fluent, she has a very thick accent, she's new to the country. So it became surreal for me that it is, you know, when you don't have those, you know, language skills, it is tough to find, you know, jobs. I have a Somali client right now that is also having the same problems. She's not getting called for interviews, but, you know, I'm thinking, you know, the issues are similar because you're seeing the name. But they don't get employed because, you know, it takes longer compared to an Iraqi refugee, compared to a refugee that came from, you know, Eastern Europe. And that's because they're coming from cultures that are exposed to Western lifestyles. You know, they were educated in their languages, but at least, you know, it's easier to learn English if you can write, if you have, you know, the skills, the motor skills to hold a pen, things that we take for granted. These communities are coming from, you know, places where, you know, that is not the case. The Congolese are even, you know, much, I would say, advanced in literacy skills compared to Somalis. So then you see a lot of Somali refugees living in, you know, public assistance, had housing, not because they love to live in those kinds of environments. It's not because they want to be a public burden, but once housing runs out and employment is not in place, they don't have any option but to, you know, seek a assistance from the government. So you see lots of refugees who are coming from Somali backgrounds, you know, living in public housing. It's because the employment barriers are just, you know, they're immense compared to several other groups. When you look at, the children, parents are not very, they don't trust the system because of issues of, you know, my child is going to be brainwashed. I want to preserve my religion. And that is happening because of misunderstanding or, lack of an education of how things work. So you see parents that have little children, and I talk about this because I'm very passionate about little children and, you know, services for them. You see kids that have sometimes developmental issues that are being kept home because mom is hesitant to take this child to a Head Start program or to take this kid to a daycare because they believe that the child is going to, you know, something is going to change about this child. They're a little hesitant with older children because they know that the older children have been taught, you know, they've been taught the Quran, they've been taught, you know, the Somali culture, they know, and won't be manipulated easily. But for the little kids, they are not seeking services for them. We literally saw kids, this was in Tucson, Arizona, who had major developmental issues that were not reported, you know, and this had, you know, missed, this was missed by the resettlement agencies. I don't know how that happened, but we had three families that had three kids that had developmental disabilities, and they were very hesitant to enroll them in schools. Sometimes it's because they're not aware that those services are available for the children, because they're coming from, you know, cultures where disability is shunned, mental health is shunned. If you have speech issues, you know, it's believed that there's something wrong with you, there's a curse. So, you know, spreading out word that in America or in Arizona, we have services for the kids, you don't have to keep your kid at home. And if these things are identified early on, then, you know, there's better chances for these kids to have, you know, a successful future. So I think educating the parents, educating the families, and, you know, ASU has, you know, so many resources, resources around, you know, your people, you know, just like you said, you're doing, you know, you're coordinating internships, so targeting them so that, you know, there's partnership with the resettlement agencies, partnership with, mutual assistance associations, because they sometimes, you know, refugee groups hesitate to go to the resettlement agencies or anybody that is told to provide services for them because they think they're going to be a burden. They're not going to be catered to, and so they go to the mutual assistance associations. And the mutual assistance associations are easier to work with for them because they speak the same language, they represent them. So I think more partnerships, you know, going into the communities, and talking to them and educating them and just, you know, extending scholarship to the youth so that the youth are trained in areas of psychology, areas of social work. I think there's a high need for Somali social workers who can speak with the client, without, you know, the families and provide, you know, professional service, you know, yet, you know, culturally competent. So is there anything else that you guys would want to hear?
Oh, I'm sure there are many questions. Yeah. Thank you so much. It's great to have that to think about.
Sure.
And for those of you who introduced yourself before our guest speaker arrives, you can introduce yourself again when you ask a question so she knows a little bit about who you are and what your perspective is. But yes, thank you for that. And yes, I think we have lots of questions.
Go first.
Yeah.
So my name is Eric. I'm a PhD student in educational policy. I'm just curious to know, in your experience, have you noticed any particular resources that have been helpful in helping students achieve success, helping newcomer students? any structures in place or any
Are you thinking about a particular age group?
So K through 12.
I would say Tucson Unified School District has been very impressive in the way they welcome the refugee kids. I want to say they call it the international schools, or they have a department or a unit in there where they're specifically working with refugee kids. And what they did is they hired about eight, youth who speak the language, who were seniors in high school. So the first batches of, refugees that came, when they finished high school, they were hired to become interpreters, but they do more than interpretation. And so they work with the kids, they try to identify services for them, if they need case management, if they need assistance with homework, if they need assistance with, uniform or, stuff like that. So every kid is having this, interpreter, but it's a mentor.
Right.
They also have the case workers that are working with them from the resettlement agencies. So I feel like they do get, co-case management, both from the school and from the resettlement agencies. And so that provides them, enough attention, things that are missed by the resettlement agencies are picked on by this mentor that is, representing their interest, and those mentors, don't have big caseloads as the resettlement agencies would have big caseloads. They do have about 5 to 8 kids, and I thought that was intimate, and Tucson Unified School District has been doing a lot of presentations, about their model, and it's one that I like, and I think it's made an impact in that community.
Are you aware of any other school districts that do that?
No, I don't. I do know that the state refugee program has supplemental funding from the federal government. It's called the Refugee School Impact Grant. Mm-hmm. And that funding is specifically targeted to help schools that are impacted by refugees. So, for example, Phoenix School District, or Washington Elementary, or Chandler Unified, impacted schools, Glendale is, they're getting additional funds. It's not big, sums of money, but it's small, but provides services that are critical to that, school that has a specific population or many populations. So like they pay for summer schooling, that otherwise wouldn't be paid for by, mainstream, title funds. So I would say that most of the schools are doing a good job, working with the refugee kids, but there are just some instances where, some things are not picked or some things are misinterpreted, where kids either end up in child welfare systems or, they end up quitting school because they're discouraged, or, they just decide to passively, not do well.
Thank you.
I was curious about the experiences of the kids who end up in the child welfare system and about the work you're doing now.
Mm-hmm. So a lot of the kids that end up in the child welfare system, I want to say some, very few, rightfully get in there.
Yeah.
But a majority, it's because of misunderstandings, because of the cultural interpretation of child rearing compared to the American way of doing disciplining a child. A lot of the times, the parents are not aware of their rights, they're not aware of what they can do to not end where they end up. And it's just very sad. There's a lot of refugee families that are in the state's child welfare system. A lot of Congolese, many Somalis, Iraqis as well. But the Somalis, it's mostly because parent wants child not to do certain things, like I'm just gonna think about one case, that came into my care, Child was seen very sad or very withdrawn at school, and when asked by the teacher, she said it's because my mom doesn't want to be an American, and so she was taken for counseling and she started opening up, and you know, she said, my mom doesn't want me to remove my scarf, and, you know, I'm very sad. I'm not, you know, allowed to see anybody. You know, she just started talking about a lot of things, and that was taken as, you know, mom neglecting child's mental health needs, because she did say that she feels isolated, and I'm sure she feels isolated because, you know, she probably didn't fit in at school. You know, there was a lot of other issues, but mom was pregnant, she had 6 kids, and in one of the meetings, she said, she verbalized that she doesn't want anything to do with DCS or any social worker, because she's trying to protect the child that is, you know, about to be born. She doesn't want any of this mess. So that was taken as child doesn't want, I mean, mom doesn't want her children. So they rushed into severing, you know, the rights. And so I feel like if there was, you know, proper interpretation, yeah, if there was somebody, a social worker that understood, you know, the circumstances of this one, because they were pretty new. They were only 7 months in the country. So this is some of the cases that I see, and I try to, you know, provide my experience and see, you know, if DCS can, you know, provide an alternative way of dealing with such cases and providing a home that's, you know, providing the cultural and language needs.
Have you been successful at all in getting them to change the way they do things?
Not really, because this is a big system.
Yeah.
We're working with one Iraqi family that we feel like is going to be successful.
Uh-huh.
And the issues were similar, you know, no proper interpretation of what the department was saying to the family, and this family is going to get reunified.
That's good.
Yeah. So
yeah.
Not very many successes, but
yeah,
you know, once in a while we do.
Can I just ask a quick question about after the child is taken away? What's the next step for them then? Is it into foster care? Is it into like group homes, like you were
saying? They look at the age of the child and the needs of the child. I think for this stage, they like for the kids to go to foster care, but what happens is when the kids go to foster care, they're going into an American home. You know, the religion is different, everything is different. So child starts acting out, the case manager doesn't know anything, you know, she can do with this kid. So she'll put up this kid, you know, for placement in a group home. And parent is also causing a lot of, you know, complaints about my child cannot be in a home that is Christian, or my child cannot be taken by somebody else. So the child is put in a list of, you know, who's going to take this kid. One of the homes will say, I can meet the needs of this kid. So I try to take the kids that are, you know, coming from backgrounds of refugee cultures, because I do understand the struggles, and I want to make their parents, you know, feel like, you know, the kids in a place where they're going to be understood, their languages are going to be spoken, their foods are going to be cooked for them. But it's very sad.
So my name is Katie Dolan. I'm a master's student in the Justice and Social Inquiry Program. I was wondering, you had mentioned that refugees often work with mutual assistance associations or resettlement agencies for sort of their advocacy and for receiving assistance. I was wondering, in your opinion, from your experiences, do you think there needs to be maybe more programming or processes to promote interaction between refugees and the non-refugee population of the local area, or do you think it's probably suitable and appropriate that refugees work mostly with their mutual association groups and refugee resettlement agencies as they best know sort of what they need?
Mm-hmm. I think refugees should work with mainstream, because I think that is the whole purpose of the U.S. refugee program,
sure,
that there's no paralleling, that, you know, refugees are integrated into the system, that they're getting the same services. What I'm trying to say is we need services that are more, you know, culturally competent.
Sure.
The reason why they end up, you know, working mostly with the mutual assistance associations or ethnic because they might not be mutually exclusive, they might just be ethnic representing them. The reason why they go to them is because they feel like they're understood, they speak their language. But either way, refugees are going to end up, you know, working or, you know, getting assistance or getting services from mainstream, you know, providers. They just prefer to. And I do think that, you know, on a day-to-day basis, refugees see a lot of, you know, mainstream, you know, service providers. They're always, you know, working with the schools. They're working with, welfare, you know, programs. They're working with, you know, hospitals and, you know, many other places. But I'm not advocating for more. I'm just saying that we need to have more culturally competent, you know, people that understand. I think training and educating the providers about refugee resettlement and refugee issues and, you know, what works for one group, because it's not a one-size-fits-all kind of thing. And, you know, having patience while working with refugees, because they sometimes, you know, get very frustrated, because sometimes the system is slow, you know, to an immediate need that they have, like being evicted from a home, you know, that needs immediate attention. But there's no such thing as immediate attention, because housing takes forever, you know. If you apply for, you know, public housing, there's a wait list, it takes very long. So, more resources for, you know, those that are working specifically with refugees, the resettlement agencies and the ethnic community-based organizations, of course, I'll advocate for that all the time. But refugees can be in mainstream. They always go to mainstream providers, but they need mainstream providers that are culturally competent, that will provide them, you know, services in a way that, you know, respects their culture, respects their needs.
Just a brief question. Your information is quite illuminating, and thank you very much.
Sure.
Pardon my ignorance. I just would like to know, is there an already established Somali community, an older community? And if so, is there some sort of community outreach towards refugees?
Mm-hmm. There are two Somali organizations. One is older. Both of them are older. They've been existing for a while. One seems to work more with the youth. One works with everybody. They do outreach. They really do a good job of outreaching to even the elected officials. They represent them, you know, within the municipalities, you know, where the refugees live. They provide interpretation all the time, even though refugees should be getting, you know, interpretation services if they're seeking services in a, you know, federally funded program. You know, that is a must. But a lot of the times, this is where the Somali community, you asked if there is any Somali community that exists. Yes, there are, and they're very active. You know, Somalis like to live in a community. That's why there's a lot of out-migration from Arizona. That's bad to see, but good for them, because you know, they get the assistance they need in a place where there's an established community. They tend to move a lot to Minnesota and to Ohio, because there's a lot of Somali populations there, and there's a bigger mutual assistance associations that represent them. So they feel like, you know, they're at home. They feel like their needs are going to be addressed, you know, better. And generally, those states are also, you know, welfare generous states, Minnesota and Ohio, as compared to Arizona, that has very limited, you know, welfare benefits for refugee families that are going to have protracted, you know, periods of employment, unemployment, sorry. So a family of five getting 352, you know, that's nothing to live on, or, you know, an individual or, you know, a childless couple getting 165 or 220, you know, is not enough. So they do talk, and they know where the welfare is more generous, and they go there. And we should not blame them, because, you know, in the time that they need the job, they need the time to find the job. They need something to live on, and even more, there are people waiting for them in Africa. you know, some of the moms have left two kids, or maybe the family was broken, you know, because maybe there was a priority on part of the family, and part of the family was to lose weight. And that's, you know, the issue that right now is very, you know, devastating, because there are families that, you know, were admitted to the United States through the U.S. refugee program, a mother with her three children, and then she's left four kids, or two kids and the husband. And so, you know, the future is, you know, not known for those families. So, did I answer your question?
Hi, I have a quick question. In regards to the culturally competent services, you had mentioned that there needs to be more training. In your experience, do you know of any organizations or programs or curriculum that targets the providers, whether it's in Ohio or Minnesota? Have any of them been particularly effective in providing this sort of cultural and competent training?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I wish I had an answer for that. I'm not aware of any organization or program that specifically provides cultural competency, you know, modules or trainings for providers. I know of a program that's funded by the federal government. It's called CAL, the Culture for Something and Linguistic Services, but they're funded to basically disseminate information about refugees, refugees of all cultures, all, you know, nationalities. And a lot of the times the traders at the resettlement agencies or, you know, the state refugee program, whereby they go to, you know, they go, because the state refugee program in fact is funded or is given that authority to help, you know, service providers understand and advocate for refugees. So in that capacity, I would say, you know, they would be the trainers, they would be the ones that provide information about refugees. But the resettlement agencies also do a good job of, you know, talking about refugees and advocating for their needs, immediate and long term. I would say that, you know, people that worked in resettlement agencies and now moved on to positions like, you know, Barbara Clinic, you know, they talk a lot about, you know, needs of refugee groups. The hospitals that, you know, see a lot of refugees sometimes invest in that, whereby they bring, you know, trainers that they pay, but I don't know who those trainers are, but I know that MIHS, for example, is pretty good with, you know, working with refugees. And that's because they're funded to do this work. They do a stellar job. They do train, you know, the nurses, the doctors, and it feels like, you know, a place where a refugee can get the help that they need.
So I interned for our International Rescue Committee in Los Angeles, and so that office almost solely resettles Armenian minority and from Iran. And so that is a very heavily populated, where the office is located, there's a lot of Persian people in that area. And so to me, going into it, I thought this is great. Like, they're immediately coming in, they're surrounded by this community that's going to support them and help them kind of transition and integrate. But what we saw is that there were people that had been there for, you know, upwards of like 5 to 7 years and still had not learned basic English because they had just become immediately into that community, and like they didn't feel that need to really, that survival of like, I need to learn language, I need to get a job, things like that. And so I was just wondering if you could speak to how that works within the small community and if there are any like practices that they do that help to kind of support both the community building as well as helping them to develop those like job skills and those kinds of things as well.
Yeah, it is true that, you know, when you're living with your people, it's, you know, you forget that, you know, you need to learn the skills. So for the Somalis that are in Minnesota, for example, I haven't seen people that were in the state very long and can't speak English. I mean, they do take very long because, like I told you, they're coming from pre-literate cultures. So, but they do have to learn a little bit of English to take the citizenship test. So a lot of people, a lot of Somalis take the citizenship, you know, becoming a U.S. citizen, so serious that you know, they'll do anything to make sure that they have a little command of English. The only problem is, yes, it does, whether they live in a community or not, it does take very long for a Somali to learn English, and I've seen this, and I've tried to compare, and I've tried to look, why is it that the other groups are able to learn first, and why is it that Somalis are taking very long? It takes long, whether they live in their own communities or they're living in, you know, Chandler, Arizona. So, but I do think that they're making an effort, you know, because they want to become a citizen. And for those families that have children, it's interesting because I've tried to look at it. For moms that have children, they seem to learn English faster because the kids learn the language, and 2 years into their resettlement, they don't want to speak Somali, you know, because they think it's not cool, or sometimes they've just forgotten, you know. Mm-hmm. I have a friend of mine, she has six kids, and she's speaking good English compared to, you know, other Somalis that don't, or have older children or don't have any children, and that's because they have to interact with their kids. The kids are picking up on English very fast. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, you know, it's magical. You know, the kids really pick up on English quickly. They make grammatical errors, but over time, you know, that gets better. And moms pick on, you know, the language. And one time she was making me laugh. She said, I listen to Dora, I watch Dora with my kids, and that's how I love English.
I just have a question of following up on the notion of brokers and in the hospital, they call them cultural health navigators, people from the community who work on behalf of the community and helping them understand the healthcare system, and also helping the doctors and nurses provide culturally appropriate care. For yourself, I'm wondering if you can speak a little bit about the challenges you've faced, you know, acquiring the credentials you have, the experiences you have. I see you as a great example of what we need more of, more people with this advanced training in social work or psychology or education, teacher training. But I think it would help us if we think, as we come at it from an institutional point of view, to know how do we deal with the barriers that are there for people who know some English, who have some work experience, but who want to advance their education at the higher, in a place like ASU or the community college. How did you break through? How did you get your credentials?
You know, I would say I was privileged. I was nothing close to being a refugee. I've never been a refugee.
Okay.
Yeah. So I did get a scholarship to come and study in the U.S., and that's how I came. And from a very early, you know, stage in my life, I wanted to always work with people. And even though I did public administration, I did get a job with the World Bank, I still wanted to work with refugees, because my internship, when I first, you know, finished college, was to work at Dadaab refugee camp, where the Somali refugees are. And when I came to the United States, when I came to Syracuse, I was fortunate enough to find a population that I've always wanted to work with. Those Somali refugees, they had just resettled, you know, Somali Bantus in big numbers. So I was fortunate enough to, you know, work with them, you know, provide, you know, just, you know, volunteer hours. Past time, you know, I wasn't bored because I was with people that I was that were like me, so that helped me. But I do think that this talent, if you know, the university can, you know, partner with the resettlement agencies, because some of the caseworkers, for example, they're working in resettlement agencies that have been hired to help a certain population, say if there's a Somali caseworker, or if there's two Somali caseworkers. Chances are that they speak good English. Chances are that they have, you know, some formal education. They do have at least maybe like a bachelor's degree or, you know, an associate degree. So nurturing that, you know, like Barbara Clinic had a program that was funded by the State Refugee Program where case managers were paid for to be trained, you know, but it was, you know, not a big, it was a good training. I think it was like 3 months or something like that. And, you know, not just training those, but continuing to follow those people and see where they are, you know, in their career. And, you know, just helping them with the, I think the biggest challenge is, you know, taking a loan while you're a refugee or while you're still new to the country. nobody wants to, you know, take that burden, you know, you know, maybe offering opportunities of scholarship, because what helped me is getting a scholarship, you know. If I didn't have a scholarship, you know, I wouldn't be here, you know. I wouldn't have been able to pay for my education. And so helping a refugee young adult, you know, pay for college, you know, that would be good. So if there's ways in which ASU administration of leadership can be, you know, engaged or brought into the table with, you know, folks that are advocating for refugees and young people being trained as social workers or, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's both about figuring out, you know, how to apply and what counts and how to get in, but it's also about financing it.
Yes.
And succeeding after you get in.
Exactly.
Yeah. Thank you. Other comments, questions? Yes.
Hi, I'm Ted. I work in online education here at Arizona State. And I was just wondering what your opinion or views might be on how technology or educational technology might be useful, one, for training folks that are providers, perhaps, to be more culturally competent, and second, if there might be a way to aid refugees in the area, either with language training or cultural competency. But I don't know. You know, if that's feasible or realistic, or how that might work.
I think that's very feasible. I think a lot of people today are into, you know, taking the education online. You know, for very advanced, you know, populations like some Iraqis, I think this would be excellent. You know, because a lot of Somali, a lot of Iraqi refugees come here as professionals, you know, in their countries. Doctors, lawyers, engineers, everything, and all they need is just a little bit of, you know, some education that helps them, you know, pass a certain certification or, you know, get them to be certified, but with something, you know, I can't think of every certification, but for example, an engineer just needs to take certain courses to be able to get certified if that is available for them online, so they don't miss work, because, you know, self-sufficiency is so critical and they don't have the luxury to attend school full-time or to come to campus, you know. So online education would be good. So if it's also, you know, financially, you know, sustainable for them, because they won't be able to afford it if they knew. So if there's ways in which, you know, the finances can be, you know, looked into, and, you know, it needs to be advertised and marketed, you know, so they know it's available for them. And for the providers, I think it would be excellent. If you have a capacity to network with, you know, the funders, you know, of refugee program, for example, the state refugee program, and, you know, say, hey, we can provide training to some of your contractors, and, you know, we can provide training to some of your partners. How can we do this in a sustainable manner? You know, that's something that can be done, and I think it would be very good.
So the thesis that I'm currently working on is, like, I created a summer program last summer that was focused on more helping students develop their social emotional skills and learning, because that's something that we see, that when they're immediately just put into the classroom and it's overwhelmed with the academics, kind of those sides are pushed to the side. And like you were mentioning, how difficult it is at home for them to deal through the emotions and just that secondary trauma of being like thrown into this new country very quickly. And so with your work working with younger children, I was just wondering if there's anything that you've seen that's really helped support students to manage with those different, especially within your community, manage with those different stressors that are happening at home that maybe like schools or different community organizations can implement.
I do see that a lot with young girls, and I'm sure in general, even, you know, the boys. What I've seen that has worked is mentoring programs. So, for example, there's an organization called AMWA, American Muslim Women Association, and they work with refugees, and their focus is, you know, helping everybody, but they want to focus on women. So they have a targeted focus. Women, that includes the girls. So they go to the homes and, you know, help them with furnishings and needs that they have that the resettlement agencies are not able to, you know, provide. But they also do mentoring with the girls. So they team up the girls with, you know, a volunteer, and that volunteer talks to the girls. And sometimes it's just amazing, you know, that's all the girls needed, you know, just talking to somebody, because they can't talk to their parents because their parents are very stressed oftentimes, or, you know, they're just feeling like they're in this, you know, clash moment, you know, when mom is not, dad and mom are not understanding me, we're having these challenges. So they just need somebody that they can talk to. So mentoring programs do help, you know, opportunities to meet with other kids, you know, that are going through the same things like them, and having one person that is able to, you know, mentor all of them, you know, together. So they know that it's not just them that are going through these problems. Other girls are going, or other boys are going through the same problem. And there's that one person that has their interest, that is willing to listen to them, that's willing to support them, that's willing to connect them to, you know, the things that they need, that has gone, has walked through high school, if they're in high school at that time, because that's when a lot of the challenges are happening with girls and boys, who can, you know, explain to them, you know, that, you know, journey, and, you know, journey beyond, you know, high school. And if people can even, you know, tell them this, you know, ASU, and, you know, bring them to ASU. Kids love that stuff, you know, especially kids that are coming from, you know, backgrounds where, you know, hopes have been, you know, really killed. So, you know, just thinking and feeling like, oh, I can go to university, you know, it's beautiful at this university, you know, there's so many big buildings, you know, they get really excited about those things. I remember this because of, you know, this refugee school impact grant. There were times when, you know, funding was paying for, you know, kids to go to a, you know, university, and to just see what it is like to be in a university, and, you know, the feedback was that the kids loved it. Yeah.
You touched on issues of mental health and culturally competent services, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I was curious, so what does well-being mean? You know, perhaps in the Somali culture versus, you know, so-called Western culture. So is it different? Because in the beginning, you kind of indicated that, you know, mental health is thought of differently, or there isn't that concept of mental health. And then perhaps, you know, spirituality kind of fills that gap. So I wonder, maybe you can comment on that. So for example, like mental health professionals, maybe they're approaching it, they need to approach it differently.
Mm-hmm.
So how would you comment on that?
So mental health is there. It's real, it's there, and it's there a lot. But it's the thinking, you know, it's the notion that if you're close to God, if you're spiritual, you shouldn't be experiencing, you know, mental health issues. And prayers and, you know, traditional medicine is how, you know, that is taken care of. The concept of, you know, addressing behavioral health, you know, in a Western culture, you know, or in Western societies, is different from, you know, how the Somalis do it and how many Africans do it. So opening up to a counselor, or, you know, talking to somebody else about your problems, what you feel, is something new to people. And a lot of the times, you know, this misconstrued information that's being given to, you know, people, you know, a lot of clients would say to me, if I talk about my mental health issues, I'll just be given medication and I'll just go crazy, and, you know, I'll just be hallucinating, things like that. Or if I meet with a counselor, I'm gonna be prescribed medications. And just explaining to people that you're not always going to be prescribed medication. You just need somebody to talk to, or you need somebody to, you know, hear what you're going through. Send new things to them. So explaining to them what mental health is, how is mental health addressed here, is helpful. Even with the kids that are coming from refugee backgrounds, most of the times, you know, they're always assigned to a behavioral health program. You know, whether it's DFCS or you know, some other place to get counseling services. Two of my girls have been very vocal, you know, saying that we're not going to counseling because we're not crazy, we're not gonna be given medication, we're not gonna be medicated so that we can't feel anything. So just, you know, making communities understand, I think it's the one thing that I can say that refugee services are not, they're not stressing on. They're not, yes, they're referring people to services. There's even services that are funded to provide refugee, you know, specific mental health. But a lot of the families are very, you know, hesitant. So I think if it's brought up during, you know, the cultural orientation, that it, you know, mental health is something that is real with everybody. It happens everywhere, and there's treatment for it. You know, and this are the this could be, you know, a treatment. I think they, if it's coming from somebody that they can trust, I think it would, you know, it would be taking a while. And it's more about, you know, accepting and wanting to comply and wanting to get the help that is challenging. Yeah.
Well, I want to thank you again for sharing this time with us. We all have learned a lot, and it's nice to connect with each other around these issues. And we hope you'll stay in touch with us.
Yes, I will. Thank you. Thank you, Doris. Thank you, everybody.